Welcome to part 3 of the FairShares Guide. In this part, we're going to look at how so-called simple enterprises don't deal very well with complexity. But before I do that, we need to look a little bit more at what I mean by complexity. So complexity is where you've got several interest groups, where none of them have got a monopoly on knowledge. And in order to get things done, you have to negotiate a consensus between them on how to own, govern and manage the enterprise. There's plenty of research evidence that thriving and sustainable enterprises do find ways to navigate how to bring different groups together, but also to manage their divergent interests. Entrepreneurs, providers of labour and the users of goods and services don't necessarily share interests, and they all live in a different community of practice. So what I'm now going to do is play a short video about Ralph Stacey's complexity theory and how simple organisations try to run themselves in a way that does not address complexity.
All Ralph Stacey did, and it was absolutely brilliant, was combine two axes. One, an axis of agreement and an axis of certainty. The axis of agreement is political agreement. Political in the sense of, if you have a decision or a problem or a policy area that you're dealing with, you either have high level of agreement, everybody agrees on this, on the problem or the policy, they want it done, no problem, no difficulty, or low level of agreement, nobody agrees, everybody wants different things, everybody wants to do different strategies. So you have one axis of agreement. On the other axis, he said, right, what is the degree of certainty that we know on the policy area? This is where your experts have high degree of certainty. Everybody knows what the problem is, they know how to deal with it, and they're strongly certain of how to solve whatever the problem is in the policy. On this axis, you go from high certainty to low certainty. The experts disagree. Multiple ways of answering the question, multiple ways of dealing with the problem. When there's high certainty, they know how to deal with it. When it's low certainty, they don't. Now, just using these two simple axes, you wind up with a zone, let's call it the zone of order, or evidence-based policymaking, where everybody agrees what the problem is, and the experts know how to solve the problem. A whole variety of areas where this can be done, but this is the zone of traditional evidence-based policymaking, where audits and targets work. This is the home of traditional policymaking. Let's assume the experts know what the problem is and they know how to solve it, but different actors want different things. Here we begin to move into areas of disagreement. Here, we begin to start talking about areas of political decision making. Different groups have to be brought together to discuss it. Bargains have to be made. Agreements have to be made between different groups. Experts know how to solve the problem. The policy isn't confusing. It's just different groups want different things. Really, here, we're talking about political decision making. Over here, everybody agrees. No problem. We know the solution we want. We know the direction where we go to. We know the policies that are there. Problem is, we don't know how to get there. Experts become less and less certain as to what strategies should be taken to solve the problem. At best, you have judgmental decision making, where experts are trying to find a consensus. The difficult area combines both high uncertainty and low degrees of agreement. You wind up with what could be called the area or the zone of disorder or chaos. Let's say if we move into a zone where actors don't agree. Different groups want different things, and in fact, they want to do different strategies to solve the policy problem. And in essence, the best you can do, it's as if you're walking through a maze where the walls of the maze are changing with every step you take. Here, incremental decision making, small strategies, constant adjusting is the best you can possibly do. Now, the interesting thing is, what about this big area between all of this? All this area here is basically a zone of complexity. Political decisions, experts disagreeing, trying to find a consensus, trying to manage the problem, mixing different strategies. The key thing that the Stacey diagram demonstrates is that with normal policy problems, actually you have a whole variety of strategies to choose from. The fundamental problem for our current policy strategy, our Westminster model, is that everything is supposed to come here. This is the golden zone of policy. And what it constantly demands is that we should drag all of our other decisions and put them into here. And that somehow all of these should be dealt with in this particular zone with evidence-based strategies, with targets, audits, etc. That winds up crushing all the variety and the real decision making that's made on an everyday basis.
So in Ralph Stacey's complexity theory, we can see that there's a tendency to try and solve problems and develop solutions in a wholly unrealistic way by assuming that everything can be dragged into the zone of order. Any enterprise that doesn't design itself to address complexity actually makes life more difficult for itself. Sometimes you need to involve multiple stakeholders, sometimes you need to exercise judgment, but most of the time you need to adapt and deal with complexity and chaos. So if organizations are complex, why are so many organizations designed as if they are not, by excluding the very stakeholders that they need to develop solutions to the problems that most of them face? We're going to see now, in this next section, who gets excluded in each of the most popular enterprise designs.
Audio Jungle.